welcome to this unscheduled live stream. That song was called Beat the Curse by Gymkata, a band that I feature quite often in my videos. That song is about overcoming your personal curses, which we probably all have, whether that's depression or some kind of vice or hang up or maybe something darker. It's about having overcome that. Alright, so what's this live stream going to be about? I just announced it on my channel about 20 minutes ago. Well, I'm going to knock out a couple of recent requests that I thought I'd do in the form of live stream. One of them is to show sort of the how I go about farming Epic Three Barrel Cove for the Orcish Privateer Boots and Iron Mitts. Those are a couple of items that I have touted quite frequently in my videos. And I think they're both really, really awesome items, and as I have said, that they're pretty easy farms. But people have asked me, what route do I take? You know, maybe they're having trouble finding rares and things. So I'm going to pretty quickly go over that. That's only going to take probably about 10 minutes. And then I'm also going to show the gear that I'm using. Right now I'm doing another sort of experimental life on Voodu, where I'm knocking out a deep gnome life and a barbarian life, but I'm playing it as an enlightened spirit warlock. So I have 9 levels of warlock, 10 barbarian, and 1 wizard. And the 1 wizard, of course, is the default that you get from deep gnome. So I had some requests to show what cannith crafted gear I use. And since I'm level 20 now, it's a different set. I talked about how I like to have a set of cannith crafted gear at 15, and I don't feel like I need to do another set at 20 because, you know, this stuff is so expensive that if you have, you know, gear every level, then, you know, you can really fill up your bank. And in the old system, you know, it wasn't very expensive to craft, so what I would do is just recraft every single level. I would just recraft to the next best stat, but, you know, this stuff requires so many collectibles that, you know, most of us can't afford to do that anymore. I certainly can't afford to do that. So let's look at the gear that I'm using at level 20, and this is almost entirely the same that I would use if I was doing my pure warlock build. But again, this is just an experimental junk build that I'm doing only for purposes of knocking out a barbarian and deep gnome life. So I've got the green steel smoke goggles going. I've got the breastplate of the shining sun. This is the turn-in that you get for, it's something like 5 or 10 cleric commendations, I think it is, from Evening Star. And this is a pretty nice set of medium armor for level 20. But I also wanted to show that, you know, before level 20, I'm wearing the hardened hide armor, and I'm going to close the character sheet so you can get a better view of the comparison. Now the hide armor actually has some better stats to it. It has a higher armor bonus of 24, plus it has the slot. So you could continue to wear this, for example, right up till 22, and then probably I'll be switching to the Terror Web Chitin breastplate. But the breastplate of the Shining Sun has resistance 6 and vitality 20, which is nice, and I sort of crafted around that resistance 6. That's my resistance item, so I don't want to abandon the breastplate, but I wanted to just show the comparison between these two items. So here's my first cannith crafted item that I'm going to show you. So this has a colorless slot, and I have a diamond of intimidate 11 in there. It's got dodge 9, spell saves 8, and parrying 4. So I do want to say that I just had this conversation with somebody that the spell saves 8, even though it is a resistance bonus, it will stack with a resistance item. So for example, your breastplate of the Shining Sun says resistance 6. That's a +6 resistance bonus to fortitude, reflex, and will saves. The spell saves +8. This is an additional 8 over and above that, specific to saves against spells. So it's obviously not going to help me against traps or something like that. Hey Utax, welcome. Welcome everybody who's watching. And then it's got parrying 4, so that's another, that's a plus 4 insight bonus to AC and saves, so that's another, that's all my saves, so that's pretty awesome. And since this is a tanky build, I appreciate the AC as well. Here's another cannith crafted item, level 20 item. This is a ring with a green slot that I have a Sapphire of Good Luck plus 2 in. I've got Insightful, Constitution 4, and Con 9 on there, so a Constitution 13 item at level 20. Totally awesome. And then Dexterity 9. Dexterity, of course, helping my AC and reflex saves. Kundrak Delving Boots. This is another item that I love, that I have touted in my videos. This is the lowest level item that has a full-on freedom of movement effect, so I like to use this really on any tunes that don't have the ability to cast freedom of movement. This freedom of movement prevents not only you sliding around in grease and sleet storm, but also stops you from being held, which a lot of people don't realize, so it's totally awesome. And then at level 24, I like to switch the Orcish Privateer's Boots, which is part of what this video is about farming for these. And this is just an amazing item. I mean, you know, even though this came out 2 years ago, I mean, at the time it was phenomenal. But even still today, this is, you know, for a level 24 set of boots for a tune that doesn't cast freedom of movement, it's got speed 10, sovereign fire resistance, fire absorption 30, a colorless slot, and it comes pre-slotted with intimidate 13 too, so it's perfect for this tune. But you know, you can overwrite that with whatever you want if you don't need intimidate. So this is just a beautiful item. I mean, it's like the Kundrak Delving Boots, you know, meets the Firestorm Greaves. Epic Firestorm Greaves. It's just so awesome. And this just comes out of the rare chest out here in Three Barrel Cove. Dashing Gloves. This is a really nice item for any tune that's doing a lot of sonic damage. So as a Fey Pact Warlock, I appreciate the sonic lore, the resonance, and then the charisma perform effects your sonic spell damage. It's got the green slot, which I slotted up with Death Block. Here's another cannith crafted item. So this is an old double slotted blank. And I found this on the auction house recently, and I dropped 500 shards for this. And so this speaks to the other side. You know, when I'm doing the Northwind series, and early on I got lucky and I found a double slotted, I think it was a belt, on the auction house for like dirt cheap. And I was talking about how like this was incredibly valuable, and I traded it for like I think it was 100 shadow dragon scales. But I talked about how like it was worth way more than that. Like if somebody were to offer me, like on my home server, a double slotted item for 100 shadow dragon scales, I would do that trade all day long. And so now that I'm on the other side of that, to put my money where my mouth is, you know, like I said, I was happy to drop 500 shards for this double slotted ring. These aren't available anymore. And I dropped another 100 shards for a belt that had double slots. You know, unfortunately, I didn't save these back in the day when these were in the loot tables, these double slotted random items. And that was about a year ago. And then they were taken out sort of on the down low, the real hush-hush. They just sort of just disappeared out of the loot tables. And I didn't save them because back in the old cannith crafting system, they were a bit of a poison pill for me because a double slotted item would raise the minimum level by 5. And I didn't want that. So I actually, when the new system came online, I only had one of these laying around. But I've got Insightful Physical Sheltering 11, Radiance Lore 16, and Sheltering 24 on there. Do I have a forum post with all my builds? There are only two builds that I have that I sort of showcase, and they're both niche builds. They're like basically like caster tanks. And so I've got my Druid caster healer, what I call my quasi tank, because it's not a true tank, but I can tank most stuff in the game. Yes, that's in the Druid forms. I think it's the top thread in the Druid form right now. And then I have my Voodu Enlightened Spirit Warlock tank build, and that's in the Warlock form, and I think that's maybe about 6 down from the top, 6 or 10 down. Both niche builds, you know, they're both sort of like quasi tanks. That's how I like to play, close quarters, blowing stuff up from inside of all of the action, and also having the ability to tank most raid bosses, even on like Epic Elite. In fact, really the only raid boss that I can't tank with both of those tunes would be like Epic Elite Sorjek. If you do Epic Elite Tempest Spine, then you know that Sorjek hits like a freight train. True tanks can stand up against him, but you know, my tunes are not true tanks. They're like caster quasi tanks. I have like 4 or 5 different series with my druid tank. So if you want to watch some videos to see how it plays, check it out. Like I said, it's a niche build. You know, it's not going to appeal to the masses, but it's if you know, for someone who likes high survivability, the ability to tank. You know, some people really enjoy tanking. I love it. I got into tanking maybe about 3-4 years ago, and I've really enjoyed it. And well, enough about that. You can check out the series on my channel. Okay, what's the next item? A Mineral 2 Heroic Green Steel Belt. Hey, Mama, how's it going? Welcome. Heroic Green Steel Mineral 2 Belt. It's got a stone skin clicky. I don't even bother with that anymore. It's got exceptional con skills that helps with concentration. Fortification 100%, protection 5. That's a great item. I mean, you know, I've talked before how when you're TRing, I mean, green steel, even by today's standards, is still phenomenal. And there's just, for me, and I think for a lot of people too, there's just, in the heroic TR process, there's nothing more gratifying than getting to level 11 and 12 and putting on your green steel. You know, and it's so many of us that have been playing for a long time, you know. Like back in the day, like farming for our green steel before there were raid timers and we had multiple tunes that we could run Shroud every day on, you know, because we wanted to be able to run it every day. You know, there was no way to go around the 3-day wait, so we had to have multiple tunes flagged, and it just seemed, you know, forever. You know, when you're a noob, it seems like it takes forever to get your green steel, and you finally get it, and you work so hard, and then you just love it. And so still to this day, I really just, I get to 11 and 12, and I'm like, ah, my green steel. It's like shaking hands with an old friend. Okay, Nightsinger's Mantle. So this is a really cool item for a tune, for like a caster that does sonic damage. So it's got 2 slots, really cool. This is the elite version. The normal version, I think, and the hard version only has 1 slot. Perform 15, so again, that affects sonic damage. I don't understand how many bard levels, so I'm not fascinated or anything, but for perform skill does affect sonic spells damage. Blindness immunity, that's cool. I actually have blindness immunity slotted too, so I guess that's a little redundant. But it's the Night Singer, it's cool. 5% chance on sonic spell hit to blind targets for 6 seconds, so that's kind of neat. Then we have the Empowered Dragon Scale. This comes from the end chest of Search and Rescue, one of the newer quests in Evening Star next to the Evening Star Tavern. It's got the green slot on it, which I have Topaz of Blindness Immunity on, again, redundant. Fire Resistance, Insightful Fortitude saves. Quality Con 1, False Life 32. Really just a very, very nice general purpose trinket for just about any tune. It's bound to account even after you equip it, so it's nice to have one of those bouncing around your account. Haven't really, Utax, I haven't thought about splashing Warlock into my Druid build. I do, generally speaking, like my pure builds, and even though my Druid build is 1 Wizard now, because it's a Deep Gnome, and I just decided to keep the 1 Wizard level because there actually is some stuff that's really nice for a tank, you know, with the Mage Armor, for example. And then some first level Wizard spells are pretty cool to be able to cast, too. Okay, this is an item that I wouldn't normally wear full-time because I'd be able to cast Deathblock by this point on my regular build, because in the Tainted Scholar Tree, once you get up to Tier 4 and 8, you have the ability to cast Death Ward, which gets added to your spellbook, but this requires Warlock level 12, which I can't get on this life. So I really, really hate getting level drained. You know, I know a lot of people wouldn't wear this full time. They would just switch to it if they were getting level drained. But like I said, for me, I really, really don't like being level drained. So I actually have two of these, and this comes from, you know, doing the necro quests, and you get the little silver flame thingy dingy, and you upgrade it in the altars. And there's sort of a, I'll mention too, because I have two of them in my inventory. If one depletes, I switch to the other one. There's sort of a little trick that you have to do if you want to get multiple ones. So when you TR, keep the one that you already have in the TR cache. Don't even put it in your bank, because even if you have it in your bank, you won't be able to get another one, like the base item, to start upgrading it. So keep it in your TR cache until you pick up another one, and you can get another one like every life. Anyways, it has death block on it and 10 charges of basically level drain absorption. And like I said, I have two of those. What I need to do is I need to get my Eternal Potion of Death Ward in my inventory. I don't have that right now, just in case. Pansophic Circlet, so this is a great general potency item. Honestly, probably don't even need it on this tune, because I have potency covered elsewhere. Even in Insightful Potency, I have covered, at least for my light damage, which is covering most of it. It's helping. It's just not as helpful as it might be on sort of a more traditional caster. Okay, Fanyan, a wonderful, wonderful caster shield. This has zero arcane spell failure on it, natively, because it's both Twilight and Mithril. This is a level 14 shield that comes from the Shield of Legends turn-in in Upper Necro. If you happen to have an old version, because those Shield of Legends went through two rounds of updating, the old version, which does not have a slot, is level 12, but the newer versions, which is what this is level 14, has a purple slot. Archmagi, greater false life, no arcane spell failure, purple slot, wonderful for a caster. And this is my final cannith crafted item for level 20. Why do I have a kukri? Because it looks cool. That's why, and that's all. I don't care about melee damage, even though I do have a meteoric star ruby slotted in there. That's just for fun. No other reason, really. So it's got Radiance 111, Insightful Radiance 55, and Insightful Balance 8. Why Insightful Balance 8? Well, there wasn't really anything super exciting for me to put in that extra slot. And, you know, Balance helps me out as a tank. What I would normally be using on my neck is the Vim and Vigor at this level. So this is the only item that would be there if I was sort of doing my normal build, because I'd be able to cast Death Ward. This comes out of I think the end chest. I don't know if it's the optional chest, or in any event, it comes from the end of Terminal Delirium in the 12. This is a beautiful necklace. It's bound to account, so you can bounce it around your tunes. Green slot, strength 7, greater false life, greater heroism all on, natural armor 6, really has stats that's great for really any tune. Because even if you're not like a melee or something, strength is still valuable because it helps you not be burdened from all the crap in your bags. Okay, so I already talked about the Orcish Privateer Boots. I'm going to mention the Iron Mitts. This also comes from the Slayer Zone out here from the rare chests. But I just checked up on the wiki, and it said that it also can come from the end chest of Prove Your Worth. Which, I don't know if I didn't realize or just forgot, but I was recently showcasing this in the Northwind series. I'm using these on Northwind because they're just a great general purpose set of gloves to have at level 24. I mean, even for veteran players, I'll wear this on my tunes. Colorless slot, strength 8 again, everybody needs a little bit of strength. Healing amp, vitality 40, resistance 7. This is good for any tune. Bound to account, you got to have at least one of these bouncing around your account, you know, so you can move around as needed. But especially great for new players, because this is a really easy farm. And it's just awesome for level 24. Okay. So these are the two items I'm going to talk about farming. And so the request, and this has been one of my most requested things lately, is, you know, how to farm for the mitts and the boots. You know, I talk about them a lot. And I'm just going to show you what I do. I'm going to show you my little path, my circle that I take that hits quite a few rares. I'm not trying to say this is the best or most efficient way. I'm just showing you what I do. So first off, there can be a ship, a pirate ship right there. And it doesn't look like he's there, but I just got a message that there is a pirate ship. So there's another one straight ahead. So that one is probably up. So here's our first rare. Oh, and I should have been looking along the side there too as I was running up here. I got distracted by the ship. There can be a rare like along the side, so you want to watch, you want to look there, and you want to look on the other side too, because there can be a rare up there. You don't need to go way over there, but just make sure you look. Alright, so this one, you actually board the ship, and you go down there and you destroy the engine, and then you get the hell off of it before it explodes. But I'm curious, can we, do you think we can survive the explosion? I mean, we got a shrine right there, right? So let's see what happens. I'm gonna toss my shining through, and I'm just gonna let the ship explode. Here we go. Dead. Negative 20. Exactly. So that makes me. That makes me think that it was going to kill me anyways, and that it's not damage unless it just happened to be that exact right amount of damage. It's okay, there's a shrine right here. So normally, if you're not trying to be a smartass on the live stream, you just want to, you know, leave the ship and get a little bit away from it. You don't have to get that far away from it. Okay, so there can be another rare, like, right here. I think he can be up here, too. So you want to check out that. These rares aren't in static locations. They can be in a variety of locations. And then I like to come over here because there is a collectible. And you're looking along here. Jack Jibbers, the rare, can be along the beach. There can also be a pirate ship above there. So you're going to look for rares. I don't know if Jibbers can be on that side, but there's another dude that can, and then I've seen Jibbers along here. So look through here, and then I think, I don't know if it's Jibbers or another rare that can be on the little island. I'm just going to grab this explorer right here. There's somebody in the live chat right now, White Shadow, that has actually farmed this with me quite a bit. It's helping them get boots and mitts and stuff. Okay, so rare there, you'll want to check that. And now I'm going to go over here. So I'm not in this loop that I'm going to take. I'm not checking every rare. I just have a quick loop that I like to do. Again, there's probably about 8 rares that can potentially be up. And then I just recall and repeat. Wow, there are 25 people watching right now. I did not expect that to happen midday. It's, you know, noon Eastern time, and a lot of people are at work. It's Monday, so I thought, didn't think anybody would be watching. All right, so there can be another rare pirate ship up there. And you're going to use the ballistas to shoot them down. I'm really hoping that at least one of them will be up where you need the ballistas to shoot them down, because I want to demonstrate that. I actually made a video that was just about how to use the ballistas, because a lot of people struggle using them, but then the audio didn't work. So I had to pitch that, and it was too bad because I blew up one of my guildies on that video, and it was really funny. Oh well. So I like to come along the beach here. Not a good run for rares. These trees of death, even though they're red name, actually they're not rares, so you're not going to get anything special for killing them other than one slayer. Oh yeah, Tommy, you're right. It's Martin Luther King Day. Martin Luther King Jr. Day. So a lot of people have the day off. Totally forgot about that. And this is a, well, I'm only level 20, so I'm a little below the level of the zone, but that's not a problem. And I want to show you something too, because I see people posting LFMs, and I think most of the time it's people a little bit newer. But just in case, and for those of you who are watching or watching the live stream later, that if you click on, you know, the quest box at whatever objective, you can see it tells you the level range. So this is a level 25 zone, and it says you must be in the level range of 20 to 29 to get full experience for this. So if there was like a level 30 in here, I wouldn't get anything for that. But the important point here is that you can have anybody in that range. So if you're posting a Slayer group, you want to post it for level 20 to 29. It doesn't follow the same 3-level limit like normal quest does. You know, if you have somebody that's more than three levels away, then they get a penalty or potentially no XP. If you're doing Slayers, it's anything in that range is fine. So I'm looking around here, looking for rares still. If I don't get a pirate ship, then I'm going to recall and reset and do another one, because like I said, I really want to show how the ballistas work. It's very easy, but like I said, some people struggle with them. So it can help when somebody's explaining it and you can see me doing it. And then after this loop, and after I show how to do, there could be a rare right here. After I finish up out here, I'm gonna do Elite Tower of Despair flagging. I'm gonna do all 4 Amarath quests. I think there could be a rare right there, and there can be a pirate ship there. There's the ballista to shoot it. There's only one ballista that can shoot that one. If you are a caster, or for whatever reason you need to rest, get clickies back or something, it's nice to use that shrine. I can't remember if there's a rare that can be in this little fort here. So what's with the music at the beginning of my live stream sometimes? Well, I'll tell you. So I'm not live streaming on a schedule, and I figured it when I just do these impromptu ones, you know, that gives people 3 or 4 minutes to get on without missing anything. And for the people who are watching the video of it later, they can just fast forward by it. Okay, so there can be another rare raid down here, so you want to jump down and look around. And this is the end of my loop. So it's just a quick loop, and then I just recall and reset. I'm going to come back out because I want to do a ballista. But that's all I'm going to do in this second one. This was a terrible run for rares. Would we have one? That was ridiculous. It's like the worst run ever. if you've already done Gibbers, then you can just talk to him and teleport out to Gibbers. That little guy there can teleport you directly to any quest that you've already done, even if you've just done it on Heroic, but not on Epic. You come out here in the Epic instance, he can teleport you to it. So, looking on the right, no rare. Looking on the left, I don't see the rare. Alright, so there's a ship right above us. Good. And there's his chest. Two ballistas here, so you can have a party member get up there, or a party member get over here, or both. These do a lot of damage to your party members, so it is just tons of fun to come out here and blow up your guildies. I mean, I never miss an opportunity to grief my guildies. So whether it's blowing them up or dancing or greasing them or whatever, I'm doing it. I'm just going to get rid of some of this trash so I don't get interrupted. These pirate ships can really hurt. Well, I think they toned down the damage since when they first came out. So you're basically going to shoot these ballistas the same way that you would manually target and use a throwing or like a ranged weapon. So I'm gonna left click it, and then I'm going to hold down the right mouse button to pull up the targeting reticle, and it's going to shoot where my, and I'm going to hold that down the entire time, and it's going to shoot at my targeting reticle. And of course, you've got some gravity there, so you're going to use some Kentucky windage and aim a little high. And, you know, because the bolt's going to fall down a little bit. But what people struggle with is they just sort of just click it, and they're not aiming, and so it just shoots in front of them, or they blow themselves up, which is really funny when people blow themselves up, let me tell you. But yeah, so you tell your guildie to go over on that other one, and while they're shooting that, the ship, you're over here shooting, you know, ballista bolts over at them. And they're like, what the hell's hitting me? Because they can't see you doing it from over there. They're just focusing on the ship. Don't get in front of it either, because that's going to be problematic. Like, if you're out here and you're trying to shoot, let's see if it'll work. I'm probably going to blow myself up. That'll be awesome on the live stream. Oh, no, it went. So you got to hit this thing like, I don't know, 8-10 times. I can't remember who I was grouped with recently. A few weeks ago, they were like, they thought you had to like range it down. So they were like, oh man, I was out here spending a half an hour on each ship shooting it down with my bow. So again, just, you know, left click it, hold down the right mouse button. There's your targeting reticle. You got a few seconds to aim. And fire. It fires automatically. As soon as the drawing bar fills up, it fires. Single left click, and then hold down the right mouse button. One more hit. But you can range it, you know, so if you have a full group, there's only two ballistas, you know, everybody else can, you know, throw ranged weapons at it or something. Okay, let's see if we get anything good. Lots of nice items that can come out of here. The Cobalt Admiral's Tiller is a nice little small shield. Maybe it's a buckler, I can't remember. But we're not getting anything. There's also I think a rapier. So anyways, that's the loop that I do. I realize that there weren't many rares up for the video, but there can be as many as about, you know, 6 or 8 rares on that loop, including several ships. Okay, I'm going to go over to Amrath now. Actually, I'm going to go there the old school way. Just in case there's anybody new. Somebody that doesn't have the ability to get there from their ship. Come back here into the 12. one of the videos that's been on my to-do list for like many, many months is to do a video that talks about places that are actually in the game that were going to be something but never were. So not things that they'd planned to do, like Anorak, that there's nothing in the game about that. You know, they talked about they were going to do it and they abandoned it. But I'm talking about actual things that are actually in the game that are evidence that they were going to do something but then never did, and this is one of them. So you talk to this guy and you say, I need transportation. He has three different destinations to choose from: Shavrath, Lamania, and Dalur. Well, Lamania and Dalur never became options, unfortunately. But Shavrath is. There's your plains collar there, Leela. If you need to get back, you don't have teleport. That's also where you do the turn in to get your boots of anchoring. And there's an angry meatball. Here are your quest givers. Lugaloth potion vendor. So even Tower of Despair is not a popular raid anymore. The rings that come out of there are not, you know, super exciting like they used to be many years ago. But can still be valuable to flag, at least occasionally, or at least run the quest in any event, because once you get 75 favor, you get access to Yugoloth potions. And so here's an example of one of them. And so there's a Yugoloth. If you're not familiar with Yugoloth potions, there's one for every stat. This is the Constitution one. It doesn't really say what it does. It just sort of says, like, something good will happen, and maybe something bad will happen. But this will give me +2 con stacking, and it'll give me also 20 hit points in addition to that. So at level 30, it's giving you 30 or 50 total extra hit points because of the 2 con and the 20 extra hit points. And then, but every one of these has some sort of penalty to it as well. Some minor penalty, generally speaking, a minor penalty. So the con one that I have, it has -5% penalty to melee attack speed. And then like the intelligence one has -50% fortification. But like the attack speed penalty doesn't matter to me. I mean, I'm a caster and a tank. I don't care about melee attack speed. So that's a really nice potion for me to click, like if I'm going to be tanking a tough raid boss, for example. So again, good reason to do these quests to get your Yugoloth favor. If you just did the 4 flagging quests on Elite, that would give you enough favor to have access to that Yugoloth potion vendor. I did my explorers earlier this morning, so I got my map open. But if you're a little bit newer, here's Sins of Attrition, which is where we're going to go now. This is Genesis Point here. This is the entrance to Tower of Despair, the raid. This is Bastion of Power here. And this is New Invasion. So these are the 4 quests we're going to do. Then there's also 2 side quests. There's Wrath of the Flame, which is here, real quick one. And then there's Weapon Shipment, which is down here. I gotta make sure I meant to get my panther. Did I get it? I'm gonna need that for gem point. I think I have my owlbear, yeah. That's gonna be good enough. If you are new to this zone, I did a tour video of it, I don't know, like a year ago, where I went over the locations of all the explorers, all the rares, and all the quest entrances. So you can check that out if you're new. Just search like the word tour on my channel, or Devil Battlefield is what this area is called. Sins of Attrition, level 21 on Elite. This is a very hostile quest to those coming in late, because once you get to a certain point, all of these statues here will animate for anybody that comes in late. So if they're kind of a squishy, not a self-sufficient person, then they could get overwhelmed very easily. This is a pretty quick one of the four flagging quests. Historically a very scary one, though, because of the traps were just really, really deadly. And this is, you know, back like when I started playing, the level cap was 20. I mean, you really wanted to have a trapper if you were coming in here on Elite. Someone says in the chat that they don't own this pack, but, you know, it's probably not one that you want to go out of your way to get. There's definitely more important packs. This one is largely irrelevant. But then again, you know, I don't know if those new ones come with it or not. You know, we've got Defiler of the Just and those flagging quests, so I don't know if that's included in that or what. I've been VIP ever since the first month of playing. You know, I played for about a month and I was like, I really like this. I want to support them. And I want to have access to everything. So here, whole bunch of items on the table, and the item that we pick is going to determine which boss we face. And so, which boss do we want to do? I don't know. I tell you what, I'm going to close my eyes and just randomly pick one. That's what I'm doing. You can't see that I have my eyes closed, but you just have to trust me. So it'll be a surprise. I don't even know which one I picked. And if you saw it in the live stream, don't tell me. I want it to be a surprise. So I'm using right now Consecration Twisted In, so it does fire damage, which doesn't hurt them, but it also does good damage. But it also heals me because I have Sacred Ground Twisted In as well. So it's kind of cool. I really appreciate that supplemental DPS and healing on this, you know, lower DPS version of a Warlock with only 9 levels of Warlock. Obviously my Warlock DPS is way down from where it otherwise would be if I was pure. Appearing Magic Cocoon's Twisted In as well. And I am running in Sentinel right now for Moss survivability. Not really needed in here, but I love running in Sentinel. So not needed in here, but then again, the higher DPS from the other destinies, also not needed in here. At least not for this tune. Yeah, I did a whole bunch of videos, maybe about 8 of them, and then there was a live stream that I did maybe a couple weeks ago that talked about, you know, the videos that I did were, you know, experimenting with Voodoo's past lives, where I was doing the 9 Warlock thing, and then just like 10 or 11 of whatever else I wanted the past life of. And, you know, you can smoke any heroic quest doing that. But I wouldn't recommend going to 30. I've done it many times. But early epic levels are painful. Your DPS is low. So I wouldn't recommend it unless you're in the boat that I am. You want to watch out. There's these rooms that have the things that blow you up in the middle, and there's spikes up there, and they're really painful. They can kill a noob. They kill a vet. But I wouldn't recommend going to 30 with something like this unless you're in the same boat as I am, and that is that you really, really don't want to play certain classes. Like, I really, really don't want to play Barbarian. I don't like melees. I just don't enjoy playing them. So, you know, I'm going to tolerate the lower DPS. But what I found is that once I got to mid-epic levels, it became a lot more tolerable because, well, obviously, I got more feats and, you know, my DPS was increasing, but I found that I got out so much of my experience from dailies. You know, if I'm just doing this trash build, I'm not trying to do high-end content, so things sort of leveled off and it became a lot easier. Some cool pendulum traps. These are traps you don't see in many places in the game. It's just really, really old-school pen and paper D&D kind of trap. I love it. What is my favorite and least favorite quest in the game? Or chain? I don't know that I don't really have sort of a favorite. I can tell you my favorite raid is the Abbot raid, the heroic Abbot raid. I really, really like Search and Rescue. It's definitely one of my favorites. It's definitely my favorite of this past year. It had a really cool old school feel to it. It has a really cool optional taking us back to the Underdark. It almost felt like a classic module. You know, you go into the there's an entrance area that's a little bit different, and then you go into the temple, the underground temple, and you get through there, and then there's a secret passage that goes into caves, and then there's this big optional into the Underdark. So it just has a real old school pen and paper module feel to it, and I really, really loved that. I think that my criticism of that, though, is that the boss is really lame. The dragon should be a lot tougher, especially because you have kobold casters in there that do like energy burst and red dragon breath, and their dragon breath is tougher than the actual dragon's dragon breath. So that's, you know, especially in that context, is really lame. So the boss is a problem for me, but the rest of the quest is really cool. Least favorite quest, though, probably like the Deliriums. I also never run Temple of Elemental Evil because it's just too frickin' long. I haven't even been a stepped foot in there in over a year. I feel like if I'm going to step foot in there, I need to, you know, set aside half my day. It's just, and there was never anything I wanted from it, so I was just like, forget it, I'm not even gonna deal with this. Yeah, I mean, I did them all, you know, in the beginning I did them a few times, so I've done it, but I think that I would call TOE my least favorite quest, though. I just don't do it. I will say that Rainbow in the Dark is one of my favorites. Yeah, that'd be Epic Pit improves in the poison. I'm a big proponent of making those old, like those old favorites epic. I would love to see those improves in the poison, the pit, Will and Stand, Red Willows, just all those, you know, those best and those old free to play favorites. You don't really get anything for letting these guys go, but if you kill them by pulling the lever, which I guess I'll just do. Actually, it might not happen now that I let one go. But if you just kill them outright, yeah, I guess you gotta do both of them. Then you get a shrine if you need it. So this is the sort of the end. Oh, I guess that's it. So any one of these can go to one of the end fights. And so there would be, you can see the flames are blocking some of them off. It's just the item that we picked earlier. There were also some side optionals that I could have done. There's some named items, just by today's standards, aren't really that interesting. So who do we get? Acedia. Troglodyte caster. No, you don't get an extra chest, you get a shrine. Oh, by saving them. That's a good question. I'm not sure. I don't think you do, but you know, I'm really not sure. Is all. Some of the bosses here will have multiple chests. I don't ever recover. Yeah, I don't ever recall there being an extra chest anywhere though. And it's definitely not at, you know, the two prisoners' Bourne's belt. Oh, that, you know, historically, it's still not a bad level 18 belt. Con 6, Greater False Life, it's just there's so much better now. I mean, random is going to be better than that, but, you know, historically this was a really, really nice belt for any tune at level 18. Okay, I'm going to do Genesis Point next. Genesis Point is a really cool quest to be able to solo. It is, I don't know if I would say it's challenging, but it's certainly not intuitive to be able to solo it. And so, you know, I think there's a lot of people that don't realize that you can solo it. I have a video that shows how. Also, in that video I talk about, a couple of videos of this quest actually, what the levers do. So this is one that... Yeah, Epic Delirious would be so cool. Yeah, and to have like a 10% Voice of the Master or something, or, you know, just whatever. You know, it'd be really cool to have all those end rewards epified. Oh, yeah. I mean, those old chains, Tangle Root. Oh, hell yeah. Give it to me. Aw, somebody loves me. I love you too. Shrine right here at the start, so if you're doing Slayers out here and you want to jump in here, use the shrine, then jump right back out, you can do that. If you're not familiar with this zone, by the way, when you're out here in Shavarath, you have this environmental effect of greater heroism. So you need to cast greater heroism on yourself, which I just did, because it's on my buff bar. And I just reflexively did it, but... Spare me the details, I'm in a hurry. So, very soloable. Good to know how. This can be a very intimidating quest, even to veteran players. A lot of veteran players out there that don't know how to do this quest because they're just freaking levers and buttons and valves everywhere, and it just confuses the shit out of people. And because, you know, like very few people run this content anymore, so, you know, when that happens, you lose this institutional knowledge that's in the game of how to run some of these quests. You know, it can be hard to find somebody who knows how to do this quest. And this is a noob hostile quest because you can jack yourself really easily. You can totally just F yourself out of completion. You can lock yourself out of the end fight, and then there will be no way to complete. So you don't want to just come in here and start pulling levers all Willie Nelson. You really want to know what you're doing. Because if you just start pulling stuff, you could be toast. Some guy. I don't tend to do a lot of slayers. Once in a while, like maybe if my guildies or I'm just bored and I see a group up, I might do Thunderhome or Epic Orchard, but I don't routinely do those. And that's just a preference. Those are certainly excellent sources of experience. I'm well aware that, you know, when you get a big group out there, it's ridiculous, the spawns, and, you know, you get a pot going and you can just cash in, but I don't make it a habit to do that. Okay, so first thing you want to do is, there's four of these rooms. What we're going to be doing is like a catwalk upper area. Okay, so we're going to go in like a big circle, or it's a square, and there's four, like, control rooms, and when you first get there, there's going to be a bunch of trash, which we just cleared. So first thing you do is clear the trash. And then the second thing you want to do is pull this lever in each of the rooms. Okay? And then the next thing you want to do is open up the doors down below. So we're going to go to the lower area down there, we can see it, and we want to open up these big, like, garage doors down there, because that's going to let us move around. Okay, and you do that just by pulling this lever here. You can see the door just opened. And then we come over here and see the door on the other side. We pull this big lever, and that will open that big garage door there. Okay, and now, what do these levers do? Nothing important, nothing that you need to worry about, but I'm going to show you on the live stream that they actually do something. They're not meaningless. In fact, I believe every single lever and button and valve in this quest does something. It may be something completely irrelevant or just cosmetic, but it does something. So for example, these levers here just open up these doors over there. See, it just opens up the pretty red light. But it's nothing of any consequence. Okay? And these switches here, if you look straight out, you'll see that there are these mage fire cannons out there. Well, these actually fire those, so this is another good way to troll your guildies. Now, by today's standards, they don't do much damage. But, you know, if you got a squishy guildie in here, you could be up here while they're down there. And so the way this works is these outer switches control the direction of the fire, and the center one fires it. So, and then this controls this side, and then these control those cannons. So I'm going to choose these cannons on the right. I'm going to have it fire. You're going to get respawns. And I'm going to have it choose to fire to the left. So it's just going to shoot a fireball down and to the left. So I'm going to hit this. There's no real value in doing this. You don't need to do this. I'm just showing you that these buttons actually do something. So I selected the left, and it's going to shoot a fireball down to the left. See? And it broke the crates. So here's something that, like, you can actually work this to your advantage, because what you can do is you can use the magefire cannons to blow up all the crates down there, and it makes those guys start fighting. It can make those guys start fighting each other. Sometimes they do, sometimes they don't. But if your guildies are down there, you can shoot them with the cannons. So, but you don't need to do any of that. The only thing you need to do is you need to pull that lever, and then make sure that door is open, and make sure this other door is open. What you never, ever, 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 ever want to do is pull these levers. In any of these top rooms, don't ever touch these levers. These are the levers that are going to screw you over. These are the ones that are going to lock those doors and make them unopenable. Don't touch these levers. At least one of the rooms will have levers on both sides, but these big levers here, don't touch them. Those levers can actually be problematic if you're soloing, because if you're a little hireling or your panther or your owlbear or whatever you're using to pull levers, if you're not very careful about what they're pulling, they can pull one of those and actually lock you out. In fact, I did that to myself the first time I ever made a video of this, of how to solo it. That's exactly what happened, and I had to throw away that video and remake it. So here's the second control room of the upper area. Kill the trash. These are level 19 base quests. You can do them. They are level 21 on elite, so you can be up to level 21 to do them for bravery bonus. trash, pull the middle lever, open up the garage doors. You can see, look down there, and you can see that one's already open because we opened it from the other side. See, when we were just over here, and so that door is like right there, and I opened up from this side. So we need to pull this lever. It would actually close it. And you come over here, you can see that door is closed, so we'll open it. All right. So this stuff is important here. Really just the valves on the right. If you look, you can see that there are prison cells down there. Hexagonal? Prison cells. And they are, the way they're oriented is three in the back and two in the front. And you can see it's the same orientation as these valves on the right. Three in the back, two in the front. These valves will bring down the fire barriers. But they are locked until you pull the levers on the cells themselves. Each one of those prison cells down there has a lever on it. You pull the levers on all of those, and then you can come up here and bring down the firewalls with these valves. So these switches on the left operate the mage fire cannons that you see here. So you can shoot your guildies again. Just like before, this selects the direction, and then the center one fires. See? But other than to troll your guildies, that has no value. It's just these two on the side to open up the doors down there if necessary, and these valves on the right of the center console. And then, of course, that one. These levers here, by the way, will basically makes the room be considered complete. And once you do all four of these upper control rooms, then you'll have a portal to go downstairs. If you forget to pull those center levers, then that portal will not appear. Considering doing a live stream, a scheduled event where I do like a Q&A for crafting. Don't know for sure if I'm going to do that, but I definitely would have liked to. No Necrolite. You can tell that I'm not, because you can see the Barbarian symbol up upper right hand corner. I am 10 Barbarian, 9 Warlock, 1 Wizard. So for those of you joining late, I'm just doing a trash life. This is a complete junk build that I'm doing to knock out a Deep Gnome and a Barbarian life. And I have 9 Warlock, so I can play it as a Warlock, because I don't want to play it as a Barbarian. It's lower DPS, but I can suffer through it. Killed the trash. Pulled the lever. Okay, we're going to do these side levers now. That door down there is open. We don't need to touch that lever. This door down there is closed, so we'll pull this lever. These levers do nothing of consequence, just like in that first room, they open up the pretty red doors across from us, but that doesn't do anything of any value. Once we do the objectives downstairs, by the way, the barriers around the big lever in the middle will come down, and those actually select the end fight that we do. Again, don't touch these levers. These are the ones that will screw you over. They can lock you out. What they will do is they will like lock these doors down here. You can't open them, and then if you pull the wrong one and you lock yourself out of the end fight, you're done. Nothing you can do. Gotta recall out and reset it. Yeah, I hear you, some guy. There's somebody on my YouTube channel that, you know, left the game. They played it for, it sounded like, for maybe a few years, and they left it because they were getting frustrated because of the same old reasons, you know, lag and whatnot. And they were still sort of just following the game a little bit, and they made a message and talking about their situation. I said, hey, you know, did you hear that? You know, it's no longer turbine and stuff, and you know, that the devs bought it, and they hadn't, so they're considering coming back, and they made the decision to come back. But one of the comments that person made is like, again, don't touch these levers. Don't touch those. That door is open. We don't need to touch this lever. And this door is open because that was the very first one that we opened. This was the first control room that we were in. We opened it from that side. We don't need to hit this lever because it's already open. There's a maze down there. You're going to pull this lever on the left. This will turn off their spinny blade traps. If you look in the maze, you'll see there's these barriers that are up through the maze. These valves will pull down those barriers. Each barrier has a symbol by it, and the valve with the corresponding symbol will pull down that barrier. And so I'm just going to give you a quick, you know, how to name these. You can call them whatever you want, but it's helpful to be able to communicate, because traditionally what people do here is they send one person down there and one person up here, and the person down there needs to say, okay, I'm at the barrier with this symbol, pull that valve. And if you can't communicate effectively to each other, then, you know, I mean, you can just pull them all. There's no penalty to just pulling them all. Nobody's going to get hurt. But it's nice and easy if they say, hey, pull RJ or pull double E. So this first one here, I call RJ. It looks like capital R and a J there. Some people call it double E because it looks like there's two capital E's right there. So that's what some people call this one, RJ or double E. This next one, second from the left, the thickest line you can see looks like a big capital L. So you could just call that one the L. This one, it looks like there's three distinct symbols here. It's like J, K, L. So I call this one J, K, L. And this is like the tall, skinny one. So if you want to use that, that's great, or whatever. Anyways, here I'll just pull RJ. And it was that barrier there, actually. See that barrier right there? Pulling RJ brings it down. Okay. Don't touch these guys. Don't touch those guys. Middle lever was pulled. We keep going. So the guy came back and you know, he saw how many pass lines I had on Ginger, and he was doing some math, and he's like, you know, that's like, he's like, that's 1150 pass lines. Like, that's ridiculous. And I was explaining to him, like, Ginger Spice doesn't represent the beginning. You know, this is not what is necessary to be successful in DDO. You know, like, she's the end. Like, I've been working on her for years. And I said, you know, that sounds like a crazy amount, but, you know, 1150 levels, I don't know if I said lives, I meant to say 1150 levels, sounds like a crazy amount. But if you think about it, since Druids came out, I said, you know, that's less than a level a day. It's less than 5 levels per week. And, you know, that makes it sound a lot more reasonable. But the important point is not necessary to have 50 zillion pass lives to be successful in DDO. And most importantly, it's not important to have 50 zillion pass lives to have fun in DDO. And remember, that's what it's about. Some people, I think, forget that. You know, we're playing this game to have fun. Maybe you're not, but I think most people. Have fun, get away from the bullshit of the rest of the world. Notice that I said the rest of the world and not the real world. But that's another story. I've never been a fan of that phrase, the real world. Or the term. So I always say the rest of the world. So we finished the upper area. We pulled all those center levers. It brought the portal down to come downstairs. So now I'm downstairs, and there's the mage fire cannons that I showed you, and we blew up some of the crates. And you gotta break all the crates down here. That's the objective here. There's some objectives down here, and so you can see in the upper right hand corner it says destroy the suspicious cargo, 2 left, and that's breaking these crates. Now, past lives are great, and, you know, when once you start getting a bunch of them, you know, you can start to feel invincible, especially in heroics. You know, and when you stack on, you know, if you have all the bells and whistles on your ship buffs, well, then it's really over the top. You know, you got all your twink gear, and then suddenly, you know, you're a super tune in heroics, and, you know, you're basically unkillable in heroics once you get to a certain point with past lives and buffs and gear. Probably a mistake they made there is letting us have access to epic past life effects during heroics. That's a whole other conversation. They're probably never going to change it anyways. Down here, just kill all the trash. The objective here is to free the prisoners. Another objective that must be completed in order to complete the quest. Lever on each of the cells, like I said earlier, you gotta pull these. And what these levers do is they unlock the valves above. See, there's that control room that we were at up there. So those valves that I'm selecting right now, it unlocks those valves, and then those valves will bring down the firewalls. If you have a really good jump, you can actually jump over the walls. If you could do that, I think you might have to jump on the lever. I don't know, I don't want to get stuck in there. Or maybe it's winging over from here, I can't remember. Okay, so next, we're not done with the prisoners. I still gotta free them all, but I'm just gonna keep moving and do the downstairs stuff next. Gonna kill all these guys. These are gonna activate one wave at a time, one squad at a time. I'm going to plug our teaching raids, by the way, if you are on Sarlota and you are new to raids, regardless of whether if you're a new player or even if you're a veteran player, you've been playing since this game came out, but you've been avoiding raids for whatever reason, either because you were intimidated by them or you had a bad experience in raids, because I know, like, I mean, I had bad experiences in raids when I was a noob. I mean, I ran into some just big-time jerks, just people that were just all yelly and screamy and, you know, didn't explain anything, had no idea what was going on. And just some, you know, real elitist jerks, and, you know, raiding was, you know, oftentimes a miserable experience for me when I was new. But there was some gear that I wanted. You know, I'd been playing the game for a few months, and I was like, oh, you know, I really want, you know, back then it was, you know, I was playing casters, and back then it was like Braces of the Glacier, you know, and Gloves of the Glacier were like the hot caster items, you know, and I was like, oh, I really want to get those. So I was joining pugs of, like, you know, Honda Zoria and Vision of Destruction. Just some just really, really bad experiences. Not with just, you know, not only with wipes, but I mean just leaders being just jerks, just complete jerks. And I wrote about this in the post for the teaching raid last week. And it was so bad, I actually almost left the game, because I was like, I've never played another MMO before, at least not an MMORPG. Actually, did play one other MMO. I played The Sims Online years ago. Which I've always felt that they should incorporate more social components to these MMORPGs. I think that would be pretty neat. But that's another story. So in any event, I almost quit the game because I was like, you know, if this is what like the end game raid scene is like, I'm like, I don't want this. It sucks. But then I met up with the High Lords right around that same time, and I also met this guy named Glam, who on Sarlona every day he used to lead a morning epic Von 5-6, and I'm gonna detour back to the start. He would lead morning chronoscopes, and he was really patient with new players, explained the raid, you know, told us, you know, here's how we're going to do it. Everybody understood what their jobs were. If you were new to it, he would explain it to you. And I was like, oh my God, this is amazing. Like, raiding can, you know, I can understand it. It can be fun and smooth and, you know, nobody's screaming. And, you know, with just taking a little time to explain things, like, it just was a completely different experience. So that really shaped the way that I lead raids today. And it shapes the way that, like, I conduct the teaching raids, but even the way that I lead any raids, my guild raids, even. I want to make sure people understand what's happening in the raid, that we're not just there to get completion. I want to make sure people understand what to do, that people understand what to do when things go wrong, because it's really easy to smoke a raid when everything goes right, but sometimes things go wrong, and it's important to know what to do when things go wrong, too. So in our teaching raids, like, if you're newer to raiding, or even if you've been playing a long time, you just, you know, or if you're newer to the game or whatever, you don't. These events are for you. You know, I have information in the Sarlona forum. You send me a tell to get signed up, and they're a lot of fun. I've been live streaming them this year. It's our fourth year doing them. And this past Saturday was week 2. Awesome turnout. Okay. So you got to have another body to be able to solo this. If you have multiple players, that's great. But I was going to show you. I said I was going to show you how to solo it. It's a little tricky. Especially because you got these respawns. And sometimes, you know, your Panther, your Owlbear, your Hireling isn't going to be so hot against those guys. Oops, I guess I don't need him here. Yakking, not paying attention. So look, watch the prison cells go down. Remember I said those switches down there, they unlock these valves, and the valves pull down the barriers, and now I'll have access to all those prisoners down there. I'll be able to free them and complete that objective. But I'm not going to do that quite yet. Oh, I learned something that I thought was kind of cool today. So I did Prey on the Hunter earlier, I did Reaver's Refuge, and I decided I was going to make some of these petrifying rune stones. These are the things that you can craft, and, you know, the cannith crafting. You don't need very high level. I think I looked at it quickly. I think it said something like in the level 80 to get the major ones, and it was just like a little bit of essences and some of the yellow dragon shard thingies that you find all over the place. So it was very cheap to make them. And I wanted to be able to petrify some of the giants, you know, in the end fight, just for fun. And I don't use these very often, but I thought it was a flesh to stone effect, but it's not. It's a petrifying effect. I was actually able to use it I was just playing around earlier when I got my explorers out here. I used it on the golem rare, so I was able to stone a golem. And it's a DC of 39, so that's pretty decent for a level 17 item. In any event, I thought I mentioned you is a petrifying effect, not a stone to flesh, so the point is that it will work on non-fleshies. I thought that was kind of cool. Certainly not a game changer, but those petrifying runestones can be really cool for, like, especially if you're playing like a melee tune, to have a little bit of crowd control. Well, Tommy, you can watch the live stream if you're interested. Well, that was cool. You know, this last week we had people in the live, actually both weeks, we had people in the live stream that were learning along with it. It was really neat that they could ask questions and they were seeing the raid for the first time in the live stream. Okay, so I'm going to call the owlbear. I'm going to park him there. And now I'm going to go down there. And if there are respawns that happen, then that's going to be problematic. I'll have to come up here and deal with him. Oh crap, I went around the long way. I should have went around it because I need to go downstairs and it was right there that has the portal. Oh well. I get talking and I'm not paying attention. I've said this so many times in my videos, you know, I'm always so distracted and I say and do stupid shit on these videos all the time. The next teaching raid is going to be Defiler of the Just, some guy, and I'm going to post, actually, I get probably when I get done here with the live stream, I'm going to post that in the Sarlona forum. So I'll always post, usually on Mondays in the Sarlona forum, what the teaching raid is, you know, and I always say, like, in case you're new, you know, I say, here's how you flag. And then you just contact me to sign up. Okay, so here's the symbol, the big L. So where's my control room? Up there. So here's what I want to do. I'm going to use target non-combat targetables, which I have set up as backspace. And you can start targeting things up there, and it's the valves. Make sure it's the valves that you want. You want to make sure you're not having to pull other random levers and stuff. Make sure you have the valve targeted, and if it helps, you can write down which is which. I can't remember which one's the L now. I think it's the second valve. So I'm targeting the second valve and I'm telling him to use it. It should pull this down. Boom. That's how you solo this maze. I don't usually come into it from this side, so I might get lost. Here we go. So there's the double E or the RJ, and that was the first one on the right. Okay, so I want the first valve on the right there. Tell them to use it, and our barrier comes down. Hell yeah. So if you're in here with your guildie or your friend and you're teaching them how to do this, what you want to do is tell them to go into this light. Tell them that that's one of the objectives, and it's really funny to watch them die, because that light will insta-kill you. But what you're actually supposed to do is pick up this vial of untainted water. Okay, and look, we got a chest. Boom. Now some of you may be wondering, wait a minute, why aren't you getting sucked into the next fight? Yeah, I was wondering that too, not too long ago actually, when I was in here doing this, and I was like, what the hell? Is it broken? Well, that will only happen once all the objectives are completed, and I didn't complete the one objective, the prisoners. Oh, that's to the end. So it's not actually picking up the tainted water that sucks you into that next fight. It's having all the objectives completed. Oop, that's the end too. Told you I was gonna get lost. Okay, where are we at? There's another chest that can be in here. It's just trash loot. be in the maze. Okay, prisoners. As soon as this objective is done, there's gonna be a chest over there. But I'm probably gonna have to skip. Well, I think I probably will skip it, because I think as soon as I get down here, they're gonna suck me to the next fight. Yep. So all objectives downstairs were done, so you get sucked into this fight, and you get to fight Toothy here. He's got lots of teeth. He's very toothy. See if we can petrify Toothy with our petrifying rune stones. Nope. Okay, pull that lever. Get your trash loot. Raise yourself over there if you died. Okay, we're almost done with this one. Now, see the one in the middle here that had the blue barrier around it? Those are all open now. The barriers are down. And those will select your end fight. So just like Sins of Attrition, this quest too has multiple endings. And depending on which lever you pull, that will determine which ending you do. So I'm going to choose the Merilith ending, because I think that's probably the one that... This is one that a lot of people have never seen. And I just love those areas of the game that, you know, most people have never been to. That you rarely see, like the deep tunnels in the subterranean is one of my favorite zones. I mean, that's an area, there are no raids over there. There's no named loot over there. There's no real reason to go into that section of the subterranean called the deep tunnels, but it just, I think it's really cool looking. There's the Beholder Council. So pull this lever, see this. So this selects the ending. It says, oh, I'm gonna get rid of the owlbear. I forget what it said. It said you feel like you've sealed your doom or fate or something like that. Anyways, that's choosing the ending. So what I want to show you here too is that notice that we're in the north, and this is the ending in the north. So whatever one you pulled, whichever side you were on, north, south, east, or west, that's where your ending is. So we got to go back downstairs and then to the north, and our ending is in the north. But in the deep tunnel, you get the Beholder Council and a possible rare beholder. You got Zithzul, son of ZZ, you know, ZZ like the Hound of Zoriat raid boss. And then you got the Frost Fiend of Madness. It's a really cool little area. And I did a video tour of the subterranean where I show all that. Okay, we're going back downstairs. Remember, we just pulled the lever in the north, so we're going north. Most people, I think, do the method ending. Historically, that was like the easy one. Why didn't Owlbear get dismissed? There we go. I gotta come back this way anyway. So here's my chest I missed earlier. And the method ending can be solo. You just do the same thing with levers like we just did here with the Owlbear and the maze levers. But by today's standards, you know, they're not tough anymore. I wouldn't recommend doing the portal bay ending unless you've never seen it, just because it's unnecessarily long. But it's cool to see all the endings. I did a video that shows all four endings of this quest. If you're interested, if there are some of the endings that you've never seen, you can pull up that video. Just search Genesis Point on my channel. And I have a couple Genesis Point videos, so make sure you pick the one that says like all four endings shown, and then you can just, you know, jump to the end if you just want to see the endings. So this is the Merilith prison ending, which I think is really cool. It has like the longest hallway in the game, and it was the hallway that I showed that when I did my Voodoo Warlock trailer, and it starts off with Voodoo like running down this really long hall. That's not just me looping the same hall over and over. That hall is actually that long. And that Merilith that is at the end of the hall in that trailer is the Merilith we're going to fight now. So you come in here and you get this whole bunch of levers. What the hell do all these things do? This place has so many levers, it's so confusing. Well, I'm gonna show you. It's not confusing at all. Yeah, we're just gonna do Defiler on normal, so that'll be fine. You know, I always fill these teaching raids up with like half of my guildies just to make sure things go smoothly, you know, and that way, you know, we could pretty much take anybody. And then the pressure isn't on the new folks to, you know, success or failure isn't resting on their shoulders. You know, even if all the new folks that are signed up for these teaching raids had the worst possible gear and, you know, were super squishy and there was no way they could get it done, then I got my guildies there to make sure, again, to make sure it's a smooth completion so we can focus on learning raid mechanics. So here's that super long hall that I was talking about. It's a really, really long hall. There's two red names is what we're looking for here. And the first one's here. And then the next one is gonna appear after we free some prisoners. If you are watching this and, you know, you're not sure, you know, about the teaching raids, you know, but if you're not a raider, you're just not sure and you want to see what they'd be like, like I said, we did live streams. They're up on my channel right now. And and 2 years ago, when we did 2015, we did teaching raid videos about all the teaching raids we did that year. We did a video of them. So you can see what it's like, you know, because again, I know, like I said earlier, I know that raiding can be intimidating. If you're new to them, you feel like, oh, I'm not a good player, or my gear is not good, my build sucks, or whatever. I totally understand that, and you know, you're part of the community that we are reaching out to. Like, that doesn't exclude you from these teaching raids. That means you're exactly who we're reaching out to. And I want to show you that you can be successful in raids, that you can be part of the team. Okay, so there are these prison cells on both sides. There's a door on the left and right. You go down a little bit, door on left and right, and it just keeps repeating. There's doors on left and right all the way down to the end. Okay? And so these levers here control those doors. So this first set of levers, and you're going to keep getting respawns. First set of levers here control the first set of doors on the left and right, then the next set of levers. So this one here and this one here controls the first door on the left and right. And then the second lever on the left controls the second door on the left. And the second lever on the right controls the second door on the right. The third door lever on the left controls a third door on the left, etc., etc. Only one of them can be toggled at a time. So it's great if you have multiple people. You have one person back here, and they're just going to pull the first lever on the left. You can actually lock people in here, so it's another fun way to troll your guildies. They go in here, you close them in, and you're like, oh, I'm sorry, I don't know how to get you out. If you see a prisoner, you want to go in and free them. Otherwise, you just want to tell who's ever doing the levers to do the next one. This one, because there's levers and stuff involved and it's easier with two people, it's, you know, best to just skip it. It's just more time consuming, but it's neat to see if you've never seen it. It's neat to experience it. So many respawns. Watch when I pull this first lever here, it untoggles that one we pulled before. Like I said, only one of them can be toggled at a time. Coming over here, and there's a prisoner, so we'll go let him out. You're free to go. You have a crippling phobia of pugging. Well, that's very big of you to admit that. I feel you. You know, last year, you know, we frequently get people in our, I shouldn't say frequently, but every year we've had multiple people that have never joined a raid before. And last year, we had somebody that literally never joined a pug before. They had literally never grouped with anybody else in DDO, which was just amazing. I think that is so cool. It's a little overwhelming on my part. I'm like, wow, you know. So they're feeling intimidated, but I'm like, wow, this. I'm their. We're their first experience ever grouping with anybody in this game. Think about this too. I'm putting myself out there, Tommy. Like when I do these live streams and I do these videos, like I'm putting my ass out there because one of the things I talked about. Just in one of my random videos maybe a couple months ago about how, like, when I'm putting these videos out there and these live streams out there, like, I'm putting myself under a microscope. People are watching them, and if I do something wrong, if I say something wrong, like, people will call me out. So I gotta be careful about what I say on doing these videos too. Like, I don't want, and, you know, I don't want to give you bad information, but I, you know, the point is that I gotta be on top of my game when I'm doing these live streams and videos, at least in terms of what the, you know, knowing the content. You know, I don't want to jump into something and not know it. And I definitely don't want, like I said, I definitely don't want to give bad information to the community. But, I feel you. You know, I'm not going to pressure you to join because I totally understand. You know, I actually have a guildie. I won't say his name because it's personal, but I have a guildie that suffers from agoraphobia in real life, and he's got some other real life friends in this guild, and so that was sort of what brought him in, and it was such a good experience it has been a really good experience for him just to be social in this game. Once we get so many of these prisoners, it's like there's been one in every cell so far. That's unusual. There's not one in every cell. But once you get so many of them, there's going to be another orange or red name that spawns. And then once we get that second mini boss, that's when we'll be able to go to the end. So this is a little bit more convoluted of an ending, but I wanted to show it on the live stream just for fun. Because like I said, I think there's a lot of people in this game, even longtime veterans, that have never seen this ending. And I love seeing all those off the beaten path areas in the game. But, you know, all I can say, Tommy, is that, you know, our teaching raids are so just low-key. They're so relaxed. It's a real comfortable learning environment. It's very low stress. You know, we typically don't do, like, you know, we won't do like the highest difficulty typically. Like when we did the Von 5-6 teaching raid, we did Epic Elite, but that's, you know, that's a lower level Epic raid, you know, and I had a bunch of my guildies in there were on level 30, you know, so. But with like Defiler or the Just, we're just going to do normal. And there's going to be a lot of other people there that it's going to be their first time ever in the raid, maybe their first time ever running any raid. And some people are going to be noobs in there. So you're going to be in non-judgmental company and a very low-pressure environment, very casual environment. I'm surprised I'm having to do so many of these levers. Usually by this point, the dude will spawn and... It's like every room has a prisoner. You're a perma noob, Mr. Goop, Mr. Goose. You know, it's funny that you say that too, Tommy. I don't know if you were here at the beginning of the live stream, but in my unscheduled live streams, I've been starting it off with a song, and I do music from this band, this small band that I really like called Gymkata, and I used to live in Ithaca, New York, and they're based out of there, but they actually tour nationally, but they're a small band, and I can get away with using their music because, you know, they're not copyrighted on YouTube. They don't care if I'm sure they don't give a shit if I'm using their music in my videos and it's not getting flagged by YouTube. But the reason why I mention is because the song was called Beat the Curse, and it's a song about, you know, overcoming like a curse in your life. So whatever that curse might be, you know, like we all have different things in our lives that trouble us, that seem like curses. Maybe it's you have low self-esteem. Maybe it's you, suffer from depression, or you have an addiction or some kind of vice. These different kind of things that, you know, can really be monkeys on our back and weigh us down and sometimes even impede our everyday life. And so that song, Beat the Curse, is about having overcome that. It's a pretty cool song. Give it a listen. Sometime, maybe. You can pull up the live... Once this live stream posts, you can... you'll be able to watch it. It'll be right there in the beginning of the live stream if it interests you. A lot of this band, Gymkata, a lot of their music is just about the struggles of life. So it's very relatable. It's one of the reasons why I really like them. Seen them live so many times. I can't believe how many of these doors. I mean, you could just sometimes you find the other dude right away, you know. And I'm having to do practically all these. This is unusual. This ending's taken a really long time. This is probably the longest I've ever had to spend in here. I just have the last two doors left, I think. Unless I've lost track. It's quite possible. Almost hypnotic running down this hall. So long. Probably only done this ending maybe half a dozen times, so I always thought it was just finding a few prisoners and then, you know, it sort of pissed off the warden, and then he'd come out and fight you. But it could be, maybe he's actually in one of the rooms or something. I don't know. No. I know I've just always done one room, one of these cells at a time until he appears. And once you get that second red name, if he doesn't appear now, I don't know what the hell. I've done all these rooms now, unless I missed one of them. Getting my tit caught in the ringer right here on the live stream. And that's painful. At least I've heard. I think I can pull this lever yet. No, that big lever in the middle, you can pull that once you kill the other guy. Once you kill the second mini boss. So that's still locked. I mean, we're still looking for a mini boss. It's not there. What the hell's going on? I don't know. Go all the way to the end just to see if he's like way down there. Nope. From the big lever in the center, one from the left side, second from on the left. I haven't done that one yet, really? Okay, well, we'll try it. Maybe I could have just accidentally skipped one, and then that was the one. Thank you, we'll see if that works. So I don't know if it's left from this side or the when you're facing. I'll assume it means from facing, so it'll be the second one on the right if I'm on this side. So I'll hit this one, and if it's not this, then I'll do the other one. Oh, you're good call. I mean, the prisoner was here, so yeah, good eye. You were at least someone's paying attention, because I sure as hell wasn't. And there's our red name. Thank you, Necro. See, yakking away on the video on the live stream, not paying attention. Well, so I just learned something then. So this clearly, to me, means that he, the warden, is tied to a specific room, whereas I always thought it was just finding a certain number of prisoners and then he came out. So that's good to know. Because this was the last room, and I've definitely never had to do every last room before when I did this ending. Okay, so now that we have killed the warden, then we can come back here and the big lever in the middle will be unlocked. Oh, it's great to hear, Necro. I appreciate you saying that. I have a lot of fun doing these videos. And then the live streams lately, you know, for, I think probably most of you know, but in case you don't, I just started live streaming like a couple weeks ago. And if you missed the ridiculousness, like I've had a lot of requests for live streaming, and I had been interested in it. So here's the Merilith boss for this part. Damn, it's been like 20 minutes on the ending. It was ridiculous. So it's just cool to see a different ending. No. Not too many Meriliths in the game. So somebody told me about a program to use, you know, the OSB or OBS or whatever it's called. Open broadcast, I guess OBS. Just check. Yeah, OBS. And I was playing around with it, you know, I was trying to see how it worked, and as I was playing around with it, I started live streaming. And I didn't I thought I was just gonna like practice like all alone by myself. And I had no intention of actually live streaming. So Nyoko's necklace is a relevant item still. This has three invisibility clickies that are caster level 15, so they last 15 minutes. This is actually a pretty neat item still. I mean, it's not necessarily worth going out of your way to get. You can also get these necklaces from the raid. All right, next I'm going to do a new invasion. So I actually started live streaming, and I didn't know what the hell I was doing. And for 20 minutes, I live streamed a black screen because I didn't know how to get my screen to come off. So but the really embarrassing thing was that, so I started live streaming, and I didn't intend to, and like it sent out, I guess it sent a notification to, like, I have about 1,300 subscribers. I guess it sent out a notification to all 1,300 people, like right then and there, that I was live streaming. So as soon as I started live streaming by accident, like instantly people started coming into the chat room and they're like, "Hey, what are you doing? You're live streaming now." I'm like, "Oh shit, I did not mean for this to happen." And they're like, "All we can see is a black screen." So I had to get on voice and be like, "I'm sorry, guys. I'm just experimenting. I don't know what I'm doing. I didn't mean to do this." But then, so then I shut down the live stream after like 20 minutes of black screen, not being able to figure out what to do. And then, no invasions over here. So and then I actually live streamed. Just that was when I did the Reaver's Refuge stuff. So that's it. That one is up. I deleted the 20 minutes of live streaming a black screen. But my first unscheduled live stream is up. So earlier I talked about how I wanted one of the things that's on my to-do list is a video of places that were going to be something. Actually, maybe I'll show that after this if I remember, because it's actually around the corner. Or is it right here? Around the corner. Okay, new invasion. Boom. Elite. Scary quest to noobs. It's a maze. Just like Bastion of Power and New Invasion, one of the things that they have in common is that they're very mazy. Now, I don't know this, so I'm just saying this is what I have heard. If somebody in the live stream wants, if they know, that somebody has, I have been told at least once that there's sort of preset configurations, that there's only so many different sort of variations that you can get of the maze, that it's not totally random. I suspect that's probably the case. I don't know for sure. But what I always do is just pick a wall and follow it. You know, it's maze, so if I just sort of pretend that my left hand is on the left wall and I just follow that, I will eventually get to the end. And we're looking for a little hole in the ground, and that's the hole that drops us down to level 2. But on this first level, you can find this lever, and it pulls up this portal, and this is sort of a shortcut to level 2. So I'm just going to go down there. But you drop into an ambush. So if you're soloing, you're a little bit squishy, this could be kind of a scary thing. But you are going to eventually run into these kinds of ambushes anyways. In any event, that portal takes you into an ambush. Oh yeah, that Reaper mode, I got jacked. Oh my god. I haven't been on Lamania playing with it since then. You know, I know they made some tweaks. So, okay, so every level, there's three levels. There's three levels. And each time we're just looking for a hole in the ground that drops us down to the next level. And all throughout here, you're going to find levers. I'm going to keep getting tongue-tied because I'm saying level and lever so many times. And these levers just toggle gates. Okay? Don't be afraid of any levers in this quest. So it's not like Genesis Point where, you know, you don't just want to pull levers randomly. Because bad things can happen in Genesis Point. Here, if you see a lever, pull it. There's also prisoners on the second level. I'm just following the left wall. And you can free them for an optional XP. It's a decent amount of XP, but you basically have to clear out the whole level. And I just don't think it's worth it anymore. If you have been playing this game for a while, you know, back in the day, it used to be there was a way to like trick the UI and you could get double credit for the prisoners, so it was a lot easier to free them all because you actually only need to free half of them to get credit for all of them if you did it right. But they fixed that like a year or two ago. See, these symbols are the same symbols of those valves that we were pulling. Here's JKL. One of the reasons I like Stand Against the Tide is because I'm immune to knockdown in it. I mean, one of the reasons I've been unyielding Sentinels is because I use Stand Against the Tide stances, and I'm immune to knockdown. I hate getting knocked down. Now, normally I would have that from my Enhancement Tree and Enlightened Spirit, but because I'm only 9 Warlock, I don't have access to those higher level innate enhancements. Don't be afraid to use consecration even when in the presence of mobs like iron golems that are healed by fire, because the good damage will basically, it'll be a wash. So you won't actually be healing them. Just be a wash. So here's a gate, and there's usually a lever behind, or around. I don't see one here. Oh, here, this one probably controls it. Nope. Okay, so because of the randomness of this, what happens sometimes is just what happened here. So there's just a little room in there, and the lever to pull down this gate is actually on the other side. So there's not even a way to get in there, but there's nothing in there except a dead end room anyway. So this is the kind of funny, quirky things that happen when you code a random maze, I guess. You wish I had my armor? My armor is really easy to get. This is just the turn-in. Oh, you're talking about the cosmetic. Yeah, this is the Reaper plate mail that came from the Night Rebels event. And I'm going to show you a better view of it if you guys haven't seen it, but I'm going to wait till this displacement wears off. I have glowing neon boobs. You know, like you have the ground effects on the cars, you know, like they have the neon lights down there. Like I have that on my boobs. It's pretty cool. Take my shield off. It's pretty cool looking. There's a helm too, but I don't have that. I don't like to wear helms. Like to see the heads and faces of my toons. You know, this was just like a random, when I made her this life, I was just like clicking random, and I was like, oh, I'll pick that. You know, it's kind of cool looking. But then I realized I kind of look like Jeffrey from Game of Thrones, and I was like, ah, I hate that character. And now every time I look at Voodoo, it makes me think of Jeffrey. Sometimes you get lucky and you find the holes to go down to the next level right away. And sometimes you have to do the whole freaking level, and it's the last room you check. Again, just following the left wall. You can follow the right wall if you prefer. Doesn't matter, or you can just follow your nose. Were you just not playing during the Night Rebels event, or are you totally new to the game and you just started playing recently? Oh man. I'm over there looking at the chat and now I forgot which way that I came in from. And the map is half useless in here. Let's see if I can figure it out. So I don't lose track of where I'm going and where I've been. Okay, so I definitely need to go this way. Or I haven't been. Keep moving. Don't need to kill everything. Really? I mean, you can just run past most of this stuff. And just deal with it if it gets to a red DA. Dungeon alert. Lever to pull down the gate, and it's a dead end. Be like the last place we check. Hey, I think there it is. Yep. I still get tossed around by the air elemental and stand against the tide, but I won't get actually knocked down. Okay, level 3, the last level before the boss. There will be a shrine. There was a shrine at the start, and there will be a shrine somewhere on this level. It's actually always in the same spot, but the way that you get to that spot is going to be different every instance. So here's the shrine, it's always right here. Again, how we get to that is going to be different, but it will always be right there. Just looking for a hole. I hear you, Necro. Life is busy. There can be some red or orange names, I can't remember. Some mini bosses. There's a beholder and maybe like an Orthon. Yeah, I hear you, Utax. And that's one of the reasons why I love to run with the Torque of Prince Ryum. Because it just complements, that item complements the playstyle so perfectly. Because, and for those of you not familiar with the Torque of Prince Ryum, it's a necklace that you get from the Demon Queen raid. And every time you get hit, there's a chance it will proc mana, not temporary mana, but permanent spell points. And because Ginger Spice is like a tank, and she just gets in the middle of everything, she gets hit a ton and generates tons of mana. And so that item alone just is a game changer in terms of, you know, whether you run out of mana or not. But and then also learning how to conserve mana on a druid is definitely a skill to hone. You know, druids fall in, there's a trap. There's certain traps that druids fall into. People who are new to druids, and one of them is that, you know, once they get Greater Creeping Cold, it's such an awesome spell, they want to hit everything with that. Well, if you're hitting everything with Greater Creeping Cold, you're going to run out of mana really quick. You really got to leverage kiting mobs into AoEs as much as possible, and you really got to leverage the use of your SLAs as much as possible. I mean, with just a single round of SLAs, strong SLAs, you can take out an epic elite mob for super cheap mana. And then for mobs that you can kite together, because, you know, some mobs aren't going to kite, you know, like archers or casters. But for the mobs that you can kite together, you want to kite them into your AoEs and just blow up an entire army at a time. Hey, I think we're finally here. Take care of some of this trash. I'm trying to get a Torque right now on Northwind. And, you know, I'm actually, I'm pretty far ahead of where the series is. I just posted, the level 24 video, maybe the level 25, level 24 video. But I've got videos up through the level 29 video already done. You know, I just gotta edit them and post them, and I'm only releasing them once every other day or so. Okay, so here there's the hole to drop to the end fight. That lever is gonna, thought that should pop a portal to take you back to the beginning right there. I don't know why that didn't spawn. Sometimes there's shrine here, sometimes not. I have never been able to figure out why that shrine is sometimes there and why it's sometimes not. Some people responded to my videos when I did videos of this saying that the shrine appears after a certain time, but I have found that to be inconsistent too. So not really sure what the criteria is for there being a shrine here. I'm also not sure why when I pulled that lever, a portal to the start didn't appear. I don't know. I don't know every last thing about this game. This end fight is a really good skill to be able to know how to solo it, so I'm going to do that. It is a very dangerous end fight because you can get tossed around. It's very easy to die in here, and there's a chance that I could die right in the live stream. If you have an Aura of Menace going, it can also screw things up here, because what can happen is the boss can teleport up as you're going down, and then the boss is at the top, potentially killing your party members, and then you're stuck down here. I guess you could just detour if you had it, but you know, just to be safe, you might want to turn off Aura of Menace. So it's really good to be self-healing. You need to have curse pots, all kinds of bad things. What I'm going to do is what you want to do is just run backwards in this circle. I'm in like a hexagonal room, and there are going to be these traps on the floor that are going to rotate around, and you basically want to stay ahead of the traps. Those traps, I believe, do electrical damage, and they curse you. And then it's kind of curse that's going to make it so that you can't be healed. So if you got dots or something, you could throw down some blade barriers or whatever. That's great, too. I'm using chain shape so that I'm bouncing it off the boss and it's hitting the other mobs. And he's going to chain you up like this, and then you're going to get jacked by the curses, and there's the trap. You really need to stay ahead of that. It's best if just one person comes down here, because when you have multiple people come down here, it starts triggering the traps all over the place. And then, you know, even if you have a lot of hit points and a lot of survivability with the cursing and all that, it can be really, really tough. So really, it's best if just one person comes down here. If you don't have a person that can solo it, the way that you want to do it is you have the whole group stay together, and you DPS the boss just for literally a 2 or 3 seconds, and then you move to the next part of the hexagon, and you DPS him for a few seconds, and then you move to the next part of the hexagon, and then you DPS him for a few seconds, and then you move to the next part, and then you melee him for a few seconds, and you keep doing that, always staying ahead of that rotating trap. In my case, because if you're a ranged tune, you're just going to run backwards and pew-pew him like I'm doing. Or if you're a caster, you're going to run backwards and dot him. If you have blade barriers, you're going to run backwards and toss them and just kite him through the blade barriers. And that is a new invasion. Got one more to do. Mara's belt, that's the healer belt. Pretty irrelevant. Well, you know, people have been saying that the game is dying for a long time, and there's still lots of people playing, and they still haven't had to merge the servers. I mean, I know they did it years ago, but I will say, you know, I'm doing this Northwind series on cannith, and I'm not trying to badmouth cannith, and the people that I've met have been really nice and all, but the server population is definitely lower than Sarlona, from what I can tell. Based on like the LFM panel, you know, when I play that tune at night, and I'm gonna show you something over here. If you don't not familiar with this area, and it's just a ghost town in the LFM panel at night and on cannith, whereas in Sarlona there can be a dozen or more LFMs even in the middle of the night. Let's see over here. So this is one of the places that, you know, I talked about. Places that are things that are actually in the game that were going to be something but never were. Look at this. If you've never been back here, look, there's a gate. Okay. And then there's this bridge over to this, like, castle. Like, come on, that was going to be something. Why would they have put all this in there? And here's another thing about it. Look at that big complex over there. When you're in Amrath and you look down, you can actually see the different features. You can look down and see, like, oh, there's new invasion. Oh, there's, you know, these different things. Well, you can see that from in Amrath, and it looks like a big stadium. And so it's just like, and because, you know, again, with the gate there and everything, it really sort of looks like it was going to be another quest that they just were like, we don't have time. Just leave it. But, you know, who knows? It's just, I'm guessing. But yeah, there probably will come a day when they decide to merge servers a little bit more. DDO's an 11-year-old game, you know. I know it doesn't stack up to WoW, but in context of other MMOs, from what I understand, it's pretty good longevity. We're still getting content 11 years later. Okay, this is the last quest that I'm going to do for the live stream, Bastion of Power. This is, I would probably consider this the toughest one out here. didn't need to do greater heroism. So also a maze. So I'm just gonna do the left wall thingy again. And he traps me in here. This will come down in a minute. There are some different objectives, and there's definitely the end of the levels, though. It's always in the same spot, so you can more reliably do this than, like, you know. I'm gonna go ahead and turn utter. Well, let me see something here. Is this thing taking? Can I see the numbers on this? Some portals aren't gonna take alignment damage, but will take force damage. So, like shroud portals, for example, you want to turn off utter dark blast if you use that on your. Because it turns your force damage into evil damage, but portals are immune to alignment damage, so you want to do the force damage instead. I can't tell about those, but in any event. So we're looking for two levers on this level, and the end is always going to be in the same spot. I think it's right there on this map, but just on a different level. There's one of our levers right there. You don't have to kill these portals. It's just going to help reduce the spawns. If mobs are going to keep spawning out of these things. It'll help to keep the DA down. And on the Warlock, can kill them pretty quickly. But like on Ginger, at level, I can't solo this. At least not without taking a ridiculous amount of time, because Ginger doesn't have any portal DPS. You can throw an Ice Storm on it and then just beat it down with my stupid little weapon, but it takes forever. So there's, here's where we want to go after we get the second lever. And that's going to take us to the next level. There was a portal there, but I'm just going to ignore it for now. See how many we can get away with ignoring while we're looking for this lever. Dead end. Like I said, there are some random elements to this maze. Getting some dungeon alert action. I'll go ahead and take down this portal. If I were a lever, where would I be? I know there was one person in here that said that they don't have this pack. Is there anybody else watching the stream right now that has never done these quests before? I think I saw the lever. Yep. Now we need to backtrack to that doorway that I said was where we wanted to go once we found the two levers. So turning around and following the right wall now. To backtrack. It's right at the bottom, so I don't even need to really... I should have just looked at the map. It's right down here is where we want to go. And if you try to go through here without doing it... Hey, look, I'm Jello Fruit. Without getting the levers, and there's a bunch of trap spikes that stick out of the floor and stuff. I've never played an arty some guy. Doesn't really interest me. Oh, so you've never done... Okay, cool. Well, if you just hit 20, then that's the appropriate level for this content. So now we're just looking for the end, which is right there, but the way to get to it is going to be random. That's a dead end. But knowing that that's where we want to go, that will help guide us a little bit. And I'm going to run by as much as possible. And this must be the place. Yep. Getting there with a yellow dungeon alert. Alright, let's kill whatever we kited here. Just try to get the dungeon alert down a little bit. Alright, it was just about getting the two levers and then getting through this section of the quest. And now we come out to the courtyard here. The trash mobs. And we're going to actually be looking down over this courtyard later on. We're going to be like, well, I think this is where Karate, the Merilith boss, comes out of. And then I'm trying to see where we're going to be up top. Oh, we're going to be, I think, up there, looking down. Maybe that's where Karate comes out of. In any event, she'll be down here. You'll be able to see her. I'll show you. So this goes to sort of the second section. Also mazy. Very confusing to newer players. And all we're doing here is just trying to get through it. And the end is always going to be right here. So again, knowing that that's where we want to go can help guide us. The way to get there is what will be random, but that being the end of this section is always going to be the same. And it's upstairs there, not downstairs, a dead end. This whole upstairs section was a dead end. Okay. Red dungeon alert. My builds perform best at red dungeon alert. A pass through up here. We should be able to use to get upstairs. So now I put myself in a position where I've got to do these portals, because every time one's spawning, I'm spiking a red DA right away because I ran through so many mobs in the other section. Live stream is ending up being way longer than I had anticipated, and one of the time sinks was that when I did that Merilith ending in Genesis Point, it took forever. Oh, I got commanded. My protection from evil wore off. Protection from evil does protect you from being commanded, if you are not aware. Although it sometimes seems like it might be bugged. I love to use chain shape for situations like this where you have like casters and archers that don't want to kite together. The situational blasting stance that I use, but you know, primarily a burster. Okay, so here's the pass through where we can go upstairs. And remember, we're trying to go right here. That will always be the exit upstairs, right there. That's where you come in downstairs there, and you exit upstairs there for this section of the quest. Yeah, I agree with you, Random Zen, that the aesthetics of Amarath, I always thought was cool too, and it was really cool to revisit that when they did the final one of the Archon's Trial one. Chain, so that was Devil's Details. Looks a lot, you know, it feels like revisiting these, you know, they used a lot of the same graphics, which I thought was really cool. But yeah, I mean, I remember, you know, I was a free-to-play baby, so I started playing at the end of 2009, and this was Endgame then, you know, this and Inspired Quarter, so this was like, I mean, I remember when these quests were just freaking scary. And here's the end. I mean, I remember going out, you know, doing Slayer groups. So here's, you remember I said we were going to be above that courtyard? So here we are. And if we watch for a few seconds, you're going to see the boss Karate, the Merilith. She's going to appear down there. Yeah, I remember going into doing Slayer groups and just like needing whole like parties just to kill the rares out there. Okay, now she's gonna spawn. So we're gonna look down over this bridge, and she should start slithering around down there. There she is, right there. I remember wiping at the end fight of this quest on like normal, and I was a total noob, and I remember asking the guys, I'm like, how, you know, like, we wiped a full party on normal in the end fight, and I was just like, how is anybody ever supposed to do this on elite? And I remember the dude said green steel. I didn't even know what that was. I was still playing my squishy wizard back then. My first tune is Azalea. So here, this is just a very small zone. There's two levers that we're gonna pull. Here's one of them. This is not a maze. This is just a very small lever there. A lever on the other side opens away to the end fight. You're good to go. DA's getting out of hand. Zerg responsibly. That's one of my little sayings. I don't know that I've ever said that on one of my videos, but I'll sometimes say it in our guild runs, or sometimes even in pugs. You know, like if I put up a group, I usually don't care what people do, but there's some things that you shouldn't do when you join a pug. And somebody did it to me the other day. I'm not gonna say who, but you know, they zerged through my group, and that's fine, but then they weren't killing stuff, so they're spiking the DA, leaving a bunch of mobs, and then they ended up locking me and my guildie out of the end zone because they just ran ahead. They never asked, like, is it okay if I zerg, is it okay if I just go ahead and finish, nothing like that. They just zerged to the end and finish it, and like I said, me and my guildie got locked out. So that's bad form. Like, if you're gonna zerg responsibly. And at least do the party, you know, if it's not your group, do the party leader the courtesy of saying, you know, is it okay if I zerg? Is it okay if I finish the quest? Those kind of, that's real simple to do. Otherwise, you can really irritate people. Okay, so here we're going to get locked out as soon as we move forward. There's going to be a gate that comes up. And I don't know if that, I think it comes down after completion. But I'm not even sure of that. Honestly, we'll see. I'll try to remember to check. So here we got Irisandes, the Horn Devil, and there's gonna be an anti-gravity effect that happens, and what you can do is try to get up on these platforms, and there's a button up there, and if there's a button on each one of them, and if you hit all three of them, then there's a third bonus chest that will unlock. But it's just a trash chest, so it's not really worth going out of your way. I just thought I'd mention. So see, you only get tossed up for like a second, so it's really hard to get up there. You know, it really needs to be somebody in the party, like, you really need to make an effort to get up there. I've only actually personally ever done it once. But I don't usually try to do it, I just did it because for something to do. Like, zerging's okay, you know. Some people really don't like zergers in their group, so, you know, so. Yeah, like, I don't mind if people zerg in my group, but, you know, you lock me out of my own end chest and stuff in my own group. Well, that's a little irritating. You know, that's to a point where I'm not going to want to run with that person anymore. If they had just asked, like, is it okay if I zerg, is it okay if I finish, I'd have been like, yeah, go ahead. But to do all that without even saying anything, I think is bad form. And I didn't even realize they were zerging, you know, because people were getting a little bit split up, and there was an Asian dude in my group that wasn't, I don't think he spoke English, and he was dead somewhere, and I was, like, trying to find him, and all of a sudden the quest completed. Yeah, when it went back, when the level cap was 20, this quest was so scary. this boss. It was terrifying. You got shipped off now and 40 past lives. Not so scary. I'll get out of the cloud for the stream. But I am on a junk build right now, so those of you, if you're, you know, you weren't watching earlier, you know, I just want to show you that my DPS is low because I'm in, you know, it's Barbarian 10, Warlock 9, Wizard 1. It's just a junk build to get a Deep Gnome and Barbarian past life out of the way. Just because I don't want to play a Barbarian. I don't like playing, I don't enjoy playing melees in DDO. And so I'm just playing it as a Warlock, going all the way to 30. But I like Dessert too, you know, but I wouldn't join somebody else's group and spike the red DA and not kill anything. And that is all. Well, this is the last quest I'm doing for the live stream. Thanks for watching. Oh, Draconic Necklace. So this is another item that's still pretty cool by today's standards. So it's a Greater Heroism clicky, a caster level 18, so it will last... Or no, it'll last 11 minutes. Okay, so it's pretty cool. There's not a ton of... I mean, now we have some, you know, permanent Greater Heroism items, but... So it's not as attractive as it used to be, but it's, you know, having a Greater Heroism clicky is cool. You know, you can toss this on somebody else. So that's the extra chest, had I gotten the buttons up there on those platforms. Telvi Sash, there's the Water Savant belt. Not so relevant by today's standards. It's got a clicky on it though, if you like clickies. I prefer using the pots of Greater Freeze or, you know, whatever it is, whatever spell power. Okay guys, that concludes today's live stream. Thank you for watching. Yes, Scott, you only get a past life for the class you have the most levels in. That is correct. So right now, I have 10 levels of Barbarian, so I will get a Barbarian past life. Now, because I am an Iconic, I'll have to go all the way to 30, because Iconics start at 15. You can't true reincarnate at 20. You can never true reincarnate an Iconic. It's the Iconic reincarnation that takes the place of that. If you're an Iconic tune, so you have to go all the way to 30. So at 30, I will Iconic reincarnate, and then I'll get both a Barbarian and a Deep Gnome past life, but I won't get an Epic past life. Iconic reincarnating will give me the Iconic past life of Deep Gnome and the Heroic past life of Barbarian. Thanks again for watching, guys. There will be more videos soon. The next video that I'll post will be probably the Northwind level 25 episode, which is going to be Epic Elite House of Broken Chains. Enjoy the rest of your holiday, guys. Have a good night.